Hello. Hello, welcome.
Hello,
Hello.
welcome. Nice seeing you.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, welcome.
Welcome.
Hello, just
hi, I'm sorry, I'm using my phone.
That's okay. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Just giving a couple minutes for everyone to enter. Bonjour.
Hello. Bonsoir.
Hello.
Bonsoir.
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 Waiting a few more minutes, right?
Yeah. People are just, everybody's coming in. I know everyone, some of you are just like rushing at work, picking up your children. Sorry, I'm gonna close my door. I'm still at school, just a minute. Hey, welcome everyone. You all know me, I'm Haisa, Director of Admissions. I'm here with Betty, our head of
Hello.
School. Hi. And Simone Casada, who's one of our kindergarten teachers.
Hello everyone. Yeah. Nice to meet you.
Great. So welcome to our maternal orientation. So I want to start to say that this session is recorded so we can share with anybody who's missing, and we'll send the recording to you again. So if you want to reference to it later, okay? So I think we are all here now. So we want to start, so you can go right ahead.
Oh, hello. So I think it's me.
Merci, Benedict.
So I'm going to share my screen and I'm going to walk you through a presentation. There are some aspects I'm sure you already know, so I may go quickly on that. And we will spend more time about what's happening when you are, you know, in the maternelle at FAS 3, how a day looks like, and have some insight of the curriculum. And I'm going to pass the word to Simon very often for him to tell his experience and share about many specific aspects of the pedagogy.
Okay.
So let's go. Okay. As you can see, I'm going to show you a lot of nice pictures. So here we go. So the maternelle program is made up of 3 years, petite section, moyenne section, and grande section, which are in English, pre-K1, pre-K2, and kindergarten. And it's really important to have this idea that it's a cycle. So basically, really the standard that matters are at the end of kindergarten, what kind of learner, what kind of child learner did we cultivate? Oops. So this is our lovely building. Some of you, and I don't know if all of you came for the Salon de Paris when we had, you know, this opportunity to invite you in the building with our mission statement in English and in French. And as you know, our job is really to cultivate with a multilingual experience, cultivate your children into globally minded, confident, and creative learners. And really every word counts. So the vision statement is really about, we are an international school, we have a bilingual program, and our goal, our vision is to contribute to society by creating a multicultural community prepared to change the world. So I know it's very ambitious, but basically day after day, that's what we're trying to do. So here in this presentation, we're going to go through general information, a curriculum overview, the aspect of combined grid classes that we're going to develop, and the class configuration for 2022-23, and a time for Q&A. If you have questions, do not hesitate to use the chat, right? So because throughout the presentation, that's going to be helpful. And of course, also to raise your hand and ask a question, I mean, live at the end in the Q&A session. So we're going to go through the Maternelle Foundation, the curriculum overview, the daily and weekly schedule. I'm going to touch on garderie, clubs, and camps, and how you, parents, family, will communicate with the teachers. So what's the Maternelle Foundation? Basically, here we're looking at a caring and nurturing environment. We are cultivating multilingual minds. We are very caring about social, emotional learning and character building. Our program is play-based with hands-on learning. We hope to develop a sense of inquiry in your children. They already have that, so we want to foster that. And all of that is done under the care of experienced educators. So as you know, each classroom has a French teacher, an English teacher, and a teacher assistant. So here is an example of what it means to be caring in a nurturing environment. Here is a sample of our Halloween parade. Happy children doing, you know, reading and experiencing through games. And how do we work their brain? I mean, with these two languages. So basically we all know, and it's a fact, that learning in two languages and learning two languages really develop superior cognitive skills. So it's about making sense of the world through different lenses and harvesting as much as we can the power of the multilingual, multicultural classroom environment. So here maybe, Simon, I can pass it on to you on this aspect, because basically the job that we have to do in terms of teaching and learning is to make learning effective, the language, so French, to children who may not speak French at home or already speak different languages in their home. Simon, can you give an example of that?
Yes. First of all, the first thing we will focus on, and we focused on this year, is to make the children at ease in the classroom. That's the first thing, the main goal, in fact, because if the kid is happy to come, is at ease in the classroom, he will be at ease to speak another language too. And that goes through routines mostly, because when we do morning routines, we repeat the same sentences every day, and we're using I would call that tool words to make the communication effective. Just simple words first, then sentences. For example, bonjour, comment ça va? It's the things we do, and we teach them, to ask things in French. And it's always the same thing. For example, they need a pencil, there will be a sentence for that, and for other things too. So it's very repetition, through repetition, through routines in the morning. For example, we do the date, the weather, we count the children that are in the classroom every day in French, and that makes them something very familiar.
Yes,
and that way they feel at ease in the classroom, and they dare to speak French eventually. And that's something I experienced this year. Some kids who did not speak at all a word of French at the beginning of the year now can ask for furnitures, can say how they feel, how they are, and so on. And they're completely at ease.
That's Thank you. The... predictability, you know, that at that age is extremely important, and it's not boring, it's just being predictable. Thank you, Simon.
It's reassuring for them.
Yes. So social emotional learning, character building, we do a lot on that. And here are the goals. The goals are really to foster self-awareness, social awareness, kindness, positive relationships, problem solving, be adaptable, self-confidence, responsibility, cultivate an intrinsic motivation, persistence, and resilience. Because this is really important in terms of foundation to be a learner for life. And in maternelle, this is where it's happening. Well, it's happening later on, but again, you need strong foundations. So here are a few pictures. So in the program, there are a lot of activities that are play-based, and they are actually designed by the teacher to reach an educational goal. And I see more, you can speak to that, and I'm going to pass it on to you. The teachers will go in a situation of learning facilitators and basically really using a lot of manipulative and games to allow those children to assimilate the knowledge. So I'm sure you have examples.
Yeah, it's because at that age, children will only learn through experience and through something concrete, you know, something they can share, they can discuss upon, and that is really important. That's why we are making some activities every day to make them share their experiences. For example, we play a lot of games in phonology, that is to say, identifying the sounds, the syllables. I'm talking for kindergarten especially, but also for pre-K 1 and 2. To identify a sound, we'll play a game, clapping our hands, or just a board game sometime. They have to count syllables, for example, and they can win the game using the syllables they found. And so on. That's a precise example, but we are trying to motivate them and to make them understand through games and through experience. For example, in math, there are problems they have to solve together too, as a teamwork. And that's motivating. And it creates a dynamic in the classroom that is very positive, and they can help each other, because language, and especially in French, is very important here.
Thank you. Here is a game, for example.
Yes.
Here you can see, here those are petite section, pre-K, using some sand, and so tracing lines. So here they are, as you can see, observing, experiencing. So we love that, and we love to do workshops and rotating workshops through activities. Another example of different workshops. In this picture relates to the classroom at the Provident Children Museum experience. So your children will go next year again. We're doing this year again, and we did that 2 years ago, not last year because of COVID. And basically, the children are spending 1 or 2 days at the museum, and the sequences are made with the educators of the museum. So it's all about hands-on experience. They love it. It's super fun. So here are the teachers for this year. Next year, we're onboarding new ones to have a complete team to run our 4 classrooms. I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. So here we go into the curriculum. So the curriculum is based on the French program, and many standards are just the same as the American standard. So we have 5 domains. The first one is language acquisition, oral and written. The second is gross motor skills. So it's about physical abilities and being able to act, to express, and to understand. The third one is based on the artistic abilities, again, with the goal of acting, expressing, and understanding. The fourth domain is the knowledge foundation. So basically having the first two to structured, you know, a rational and structured thought. And the fifth one is about the exploration of the world. And the world is everywhere around us, so I would say limitless. So here we have all the descriptions of the standards. So I'm going to go quick on that. You're going to get, you know, the slides. We're not going to read everything, but you're going to have this. So here are examples, for example, in writing, how to write name with Play-Doh. Gross motor skills, your children will do what we call motricité. There is a lot of that in the program, and they go to the auditorium 4 times a week for 30 minutes, in addition to going outside and all of that. And all the skills they can work in the classroom. Here are examples of physical activity, motricité. The artistic abilities, here you find the standards. You know, we have a very talented art teacher. So that's something rare in a small school like ours. So the art teacher has an imagination and a creativity, which is really impressive. And this is the type of work she's able to have the children do. So I think not only she has fantastic idea, but she has this ability to make the kids love to do arts and love to do arts together. Here are examples. Other examples. So numbers and mathematics, and maybe Simon later on you can speak to this more, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Do you want to talk about numbers
right now? Yes, I can. What is important to understand is that in the French curriculum, they have 3 years to learn things. That's not because they don't have a skill at the end of pre-K1 that they won't have in the other years. They have 3 years, so every student is can go as they want to, as fast as they want, as slow as they want. We respect that totally. And we have just 3 years to make it work, okay? So for the numbers, for example, at the end of kindergarten, we are going until 30 in France, in French. They have to compare a collection of objects, like we said. We are preparing the operation that additions, for examples, and we are experiencing a lot with manipulation of cubes, of little objects, and they have to cooperate, as I said earlier, to solve problems. And that's that we are developing their logical minds first, and the correspondence between numbers that are written and the quantity and the collections that they see. That is very important. That's our first goal, or main goal is that, to understand and that the math make sense, you know. It's very important for us. Like, they understand the procedures they are behind calculation.
Thank you. So, by the way, the standard, they're the same on the English program, right? Here, when you're seeing the standard, they apply to the English and the French program. So, into class is also something specific to the program. So, I'm going to go to the schedule. And I'm going to go here first, and then we go back on the normal days. So here is a sample of a schedule. So just to explain, what's in blue, it's happening in French. What is pink is happening in English. You see in green into class, and you see science in green, you see art in purple, and you see some music in orange. So science, you know, do not happen just twice a week, because it's a very interdisciplinary program. It's just to say, okay, your children receive a certain numbers, let's say, right, to quantify, of period in French, doing language, doing mathematics, exploring the world, and they're going to do a certain number of periods in English, doing language, exploring the world, and talk about and motricity and all of that. And interclass that you see here, it's once a week, and it allows all the classes to be mixed together, not in COVID time, but basically to build those bridges between classes and work mostly on exploring the world, so science, through rotating workshops. So we really love that period because it's allowed a lot of innovation in terms of pedagogy, and it's super creative, it's super hands-on, so we're really happy to bring back into the program next year, saying no COVID. So your children basically are going to receive 70% of their instruction in French, and that's for petite, moyenne section and grande section, and 30% of the instruction in English. The art teacher come two periods per week, and the music teacher one period per week. Art happens in French, and music happens in English. Now, if we look at a typical day, and I'm going to pass it on to you, Simon, here is a typical day.
Yes, at 8:15 until 8:30, there's a drop off and class starts at 8:30. So when we welcome the children at inside the classroom, they have a bunch of activities to do that we prepare with my assistant. So it can be coloring pages or some works they didn't finish the day before, or some language situations they prepared to. At 8:30 until 8:45, it depends. We have routines. So that's what I talked about earlier. That is to say, we make the date in French, write the date in French. We count the students in the classroom. That leads to math situation, of course. And the weather, to learn some French vocabulary too. And after that, until 9:15, we have, it depends. Sometimes I read a book, a story, where we will be working on a certain amount of time for 2 weeks or three. Or I do vocabulary games to learn some specific vocabulary. For example, in September, we make school vocabulary in French. So that's the kind of thing that we are doing, or math situations, math problems. This goes until 9:15, and then there's the snack. But the snack isn't just we are eating and that's all. It leads to vocabulary, it leads to a language situation that are very interesting, because the kids do not have the feeling that they are working, but they are, even in that time. After that, we have recess. And when we come back, we have class time too. Usually it's workshops. I divide my class in two or three groups, it depends. One will go to with the assistant, one stays with me, and maybe sometimes one is on autonomy on different works. And we, during the week, we return the workshops so they can experience all of the activities I propose. So after that, we have lunch. As I said, it's a language situation. They're learning too. And after, we have recess again after lunch.
For kindergarten,
yes. Otherwise, it's nap time for pre-K 1 and 2. This year, I don't know if we'll be able to do that. But we have a time after in kindergarten after recess where the English teacher and me are together in the classroom. That's a good experience for them because they can switch between the languages at the same time. You know, they speak to me in French, they speak to the English teacher in English, and that creates some dynamic in the class. That's very interesting for us. After that, we have class time again with workshops or science class or so on, and dismissal at the end.
So it's the same schedule for, and what Simon is describing is applies to petite section and moyenne section, yes, and grande section. I mean, the way to approach, you know, learning and teaching is exactly the same. Lots of music in the petite section because we have a teacher who is very musical, so we have a lot of music and they love it. So play at the park. After school, so after care and club, let me go quickly on that. From 3:15 to 5:30, FAS3 offers an aftercare, and from 3:15 to 4:15, club. So Virginie Gagliardi is the one responsible for that. We run that in two sessions of after school club, September to January, January to May. And we offer camps during breaks in October, February, April, and the summer. So communication with the teachers. So when we're going to start in September, prior to the first day of school, we have a session called Meet the Teachers. I hope we're going to do it like we did in the past year with a mix between the park, welcoming, you know, students and parents at the park, and then going into the classroom. You will receive a weekly newsletter on Fridays from the teachers. Those newsletters, they're kind of extensive, and sometimes, I mean, on the phone, it's hard because they are so long, but they are a really good source of information to know what happened in the classroom. You're going to see pictures. The teacher will tell you what's happening in French, what happened in English, in art and music. You most probably will find a video or songs that they've been learning so you can repeat at home. So it's super comprehensive. Emails are acknowledged within 24 hours and answered within 48 hours. That's the policy at FAS3. We have two parent-teachers conferences runs in November and March, and these are scheduled parent-teacher conferences. It doesn't mean you cannot meet the teachers at any time. Send an email and say, hey, I would like to meet. And then you would organize, you know, we will organize a meeting. Those ones are really on the schedule. They are super quick, so I would say don't wait till November. If you want to have a longer chat with the teachers, just send an email and schedule a meeting. We work with two report cards. Actually, in maternelle, they really are progress reports because it's all about the journey of learning and the growth of the child. They are bilingual. So you're going to see like competencies. And on those report cards, you're seeing what your child is able to do as a certain point in time. So it's a good snapshot of a progress. And at FAS3, we really believe in the partnership between the family and the school and the teachers and the parents. So again, I'm insisting on that. Never hesitate to reach out and ask for a conversation because it's super important. We're here for your children and we're here as a team to help them to grow. As you know, it takes a village, and that's so true all the time. So here is an example of Meet the Teachers last year. And here I'm going to jump into the notion of combined grade classes, because the model we're going to have next year is made of one petite section and then three sections of moyenne grande section. Okay, so we're looking at, we're actually excited to bring back something that FAS3 has been doing for years, and which is a proven and successful educational format in not only in France, in Europe, and has been for years. So with COVID, it was slightly different. And the reason why we want to do that, we want to keep petite section as an age group because they are actually very young and they need to learn the routines and how to become schoolgirls and schoolboys. And it's a job by itself. In moyenne and grande section, having combined grade classes is super beneficial for the younger children and the older one. So I'm going to pass it on to Simon, and he has taught that for years, and the other teachers as well. So whether on the English, you know, when they teach, they learn in English or they learn in French, they're going to be in a multi-age class for moyenne and grande section. Simon, you want to develop on that?
Yes, of course. As a matter of fact, in France, I taught most of the time in combined classes. because it's the way it is, there are more combined classes than there than just simple level in France. And I have a great experience in that. And we all do as French teachers. And I saw a lot of benefits doing that kind of classes, because there's kind of emulation between the kids. The younger ones look towards the older ones, and they as a model, and the older ones are very happy to play the teachers, and that's great, because we can see they can develop their autonomy, their confidence too, because they go to help the younger ones, and that creates a dynamic in the classroom that is very beneficial. Very good for the kids, and we have as teachers, we just have to manage that kind of thing and play with it, and lead it to the right way, you know. So we can teach through the whole classroom at the same time, and just for have moments with the older ones for the K for next year, with the K with the pre-K twos, and sometimes mix. So it's very good for the kids. As I saw in France, it's great. It's really great.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We can continue on that in the Q&A if you want to.
Okay.
So here are like the benefits of the combined age classes. Actually, they rename class multi-age, which really means what it means, multi-age, right? So as I said, we're going to share those slides. Here is, this is from Canada, because that's not only in France, again, it's all over in Europe, and Canada is big on those educational model, so you can read that. And as I was saying, this is our configuration for next year. One petite section and three combined grade classes, moyenne grande section. All the classroom will be on the first floor, and there will be this 1 weekly period of common interclass that's going to allow to make some activities with the petite section, between the petite section, moyenne and grande section. And the teachers of the three combined grade classes will work at the same pace. It's not, you know, they're going to collaborate very closely, the English teachers as well. And those three sections will advance at the same pace. So let's go into the Q&A now. I hope I wasn't too long. Happy to answer any questions.
So I have a question. Who are the teachers going to be? Because it sounds like... you know, this is much bigger than this year. So
yes,
be new teachers, and who's going to be teaching French and English, and who are going to be the assistant teachers and all that?
Okay, so we have recruited two new teachers, and one new teacher will join. So in maternelle, I can't give you the name yet, but you have to know that the current teachers are here. They're staying, so they're returning teachers. We have this new French teacher. We have our teacher assistant, so we are pushing a new teacher assistant as well. And because of 4 classrooms, there are going to be actually 2 or 3 English teachers, okay, working on that. So much bigger team, yes, we're super excited about that. And you will know, I mean, the names and all of that, but it's still, you know, it's like a puzzle. And that's why I'm sorry, I'm not going out that early. I have an idea of what will happen, I mean, for sure, but I really like to come out to you with the definite puzzle in place.
Yeah,
so
sorry, didn't mean,
patient.
Didn't mean to stop you, I was just excited. So, and how many kids approximately? I mean, is it gonna be like half moyenne, half grand, or like what's your sort of formula?
Or makeup, okay. Our formula, we're actually gonna spread all the grand section across the 3 moyenne grand section sections, and the same for moyenne section. So basically, Raisa, correct me if I'm wrong, that's gonna make up of classes of what, 17 each?
Yeah, so
she's looking at the board when we have the numbers.
Okay. So I mean, as of now, well, for sure, they will in the pre-K, well, in all of the three classes from preschool, so pre-K one and the pre-K, K and kindergarten, there'll be no more than 18 students. And in the combined classes, right now there'll be less than 18, but it could still be 18 because we're only in May.
But it's capped at 18 anyhow.
Yeah, right. So maybe right now we're looking at 16 students in each classes, but there could be 18 students. So it looks like it will be pretty balanced between
yes
the pre-K 2 and kindergarten.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what we're looking at. We're having, I mean, nice yeah. cohort coming in, thanks to you. So we yeah. can really balance those classes. The petite section will be actually strong with 17 or 18. And it's good they're staying, you know, their age group for those one. They really have to learn how to become school boys and girls, really. And then combining them, it's going to be balanced. So that's how it looks.
The teacher-student ratio in the pre-K one is 9-1. So it's
yes.
two teachers, and same for the other ones too. So two teachers per class. So
there are always two adults in the yeah. classroom. There's a teacher and a teacher assistant. The teacher assistant is there when the English teachers coming and the French teacher come there. So basically they are used to deal with three adults, well, actually more than that, and an art teacher and a music teacher. And it's actually impressive to see how comfortable they are with this support team, because I really qualify that as a support team of five adults. And they know exactly, you know, because as Simon was saying, it's all about routines. In maternelle, they are super, super important. That's what makes them be balanced and grounded. We want, you know, to foster grounded people. So that's for the, I think there was another question. After kindergarten, you can speak to that, Raissa.
How will first grade be structured? How many classes in size? First grade, same with the combined classes, first and second grade.
And two sections, so two classes.
Two classes of first and second grade, and depending, I don't have all the numbers. We're looking at, we're looking at the same, because typically they will all come, they will all move forward, so about the same size classes, about 16 to 18 in those combined first and second grade.
Oh, super, thank you for the question, really great question. How potential learning challenges, how are they addressed in a bilingual academic environment? So here, which learning challenges, if I may, because there's a wide range of them.
Hi, thanks. Yeah.
Thank you.
We're talking about the main challenge of adapting into a new language environment. Mm-hmm. And we obviously talk about multilingual environments, but we have the extra complexity of having a kid who already speaks a different language, so she's going to be trilingual. So I was wondering if there are any challenges in, you know, between like switching between languages or learning in a different language, or resisting to a new language,
or even detecting, you know, things like dyslexia. I'm assuming that at this age is when the teachers may be able to see some type of pattern, something that needs to be addressed early on. I'm wondering how that can be addressed, or it may be addressed differently in a bilingual environment.
Okay, Simon, do you want, I can answer to that. I mean, to the question of, so that age is really the perfect age, because when we say that kids are sponges, I mean, that's a fact, right? So we may think as adults that it's super confusing for them to use two or three languages, but in fact, they do know exactly when and with whom to speak which language. If I go in a classroom and speak English, the kids would answer to me in French because I have this terrible French accent and they know I'm Benedict and I'm French. So they would go for French. So just to say that really the fact of, and if your children already are multilingual, just adding another one, it may take time. I think that's much more that, because it may take time for them to express themselves in a language. And typically in a multilingual environment, depending on the individual, we can be as adults super frustrated. There's a plateau, nothing's happened, that child doesn't want to speak French, as you were saying, resisting. We just have to be patient. It's fun, it's rewarding to learn languages, it's meaningful, it's your job, it's your pride. I mean, I'm talking about the child. Putting, you know, that children that with the awareness, that's a challenge, yes, but that's something they can be extremely proud of. Really works. And we're looking at the long run, because it's all about, I would say, the goal of a multilingual, multicultural young adults. That's what we're looking at. And so much more than standard at a certain level, the magic will happen, the chemistry will happen. I can give, you know, I always give my sons as an example. And so many years of I've seen that as a French, as a second language teacher, it happens, but you have to be patient and we have to be consistent.
Yes.
So Simon, I mean, to dyslexia and all of that, you can speak to that. In maternelle, they're still young. We often give it a chance before.
Yes. It's a little bit early to speak about dyslexia. In kindergarten, but we can have clues and just say to the first grade teachers that keep an eye on that. Maybe there's something, but it, as Benedict says, sometimes it's just they just need sometimes it just happens by itself and the problems are solved by themselves once they grow up. They simply grow up. To speak about multilingualism, I have in the classroom, I have a girl who speaks Russian, Portuguese, and English, of course. And it's amazing how plurilingual students can learn another language. I mean, she didn't speak a word of French when she was here in September. Now she's the one of the best students in French I have. She speaks easily because they don't fear to speak another language because they already speak two or three languages at home. So they do not fear to learn another one, and they dare to speak French to me. That's amazing. That's incredible. I experienced that kind of teaching for the first time 3 years ago. And it's always astonishing the way they can learn, how fast they can learn a language. They're not adults, they're sponges. And it's astonishing.
Thank you.
We have another question in the chat. When do students start being separated into their own grade for learning? Well, we really love combined grade classes. So, because that's part of the philosophy and educational philosophy at Fast 3. So we will look at combined grade classes in first and second grade, and next year only the third grade will be by itself. And there's a reason for that. And fourth and fifth will be combined. I would say this could change because it's all about when, depending on the number of students, does it make sense to do a combined grade classes, yes or no? I mean, there is the thing that we know it's super beneficial, but there are also at play will it be balanced? Will it make sense? And when we look at the cycles in the French system, because the French system is built on cycle of 3 years, the CO2 third grade is really like a, there's a big jump between CPCE1 and CO2, and another big jump in fourth and fifth. So it really makes sense there to have a one level classroom. That is really my best answer, but maybe next year we're gonna use that something different and the year after, and I would explain why we're making those choices. It's all about the quality of your teachers in the classroom and the, how you're gonna make it happen in the classroom. And also the ability to, between the students and the teachers, to build connections. It really starts, and coming back to how challenging it is, it's we have happy children. And honestly, maybe that's 70% of the job is to foster the joy of learning, because then it's happened. Maybe 70%, I'm too high, but it's more than 50% for sure. Oh, info on the clubs. Raisa, do you want to develop on that? I know there are big variety of clubs and they change every semester. Virginie is our pro on that.
Mm-hmm. So, thank you, Anna. Anna put
thank you.
Of the enrichment clubs in the chat. But clubs are offered every semester, and new clubs are offered every semester for the fall and the spring. There's some clubs that will continue because they are very popular, like cooking and piano. They run from the first clubs run from September through mid-January, then January to June. You will be able to register for next fall's club in late August, beginning of September, because they will start by the second week of September, because we want to give a chance for any newcomers to be able to sign up, because they get filled up pretty fast.
Yes, we have best of. Cooking is one, coding robotic is a big one. The zoo club is zoo a big club. One with maternelle.
Yes.
Dance, right?
Dance, yes.
Ballet.
And also piano that gets filled up and the slots too, because they are on 20-minute slots.
Yep. Well, thank you, Anna.
Thank you
for sharing your experience. Thank you.
See, you were you have experience with clubs. Thank you.
Yeah, and you know, I have three kids, so I cannot possibly shuttle them all over Rhode Island. So they're stuck with whatever FASRI offers. Well, I mean, Marie's so far, just Marie's at FASRI, and so far she's been delighted. So definitely, highly recommend them.
And we also have the summer camp that's going to be starting in June. So after this, so I already sent our new families summer camp information. So the registration is open and there's still room. So if you wanted to get kind of a taste of what FASRI is like, you can sign up for any number of weeks that you want.
It's a good introduction, it's true, yeah. And especially for new students, because they get familiar with the building and they get familiar, if you don't speak French, they get familiar with French.
And then that first day of school is not so scary.
Yeah.
Any more questions? Now, either we did a good job or you guys are really...
Oh, hold on. Another question. When is the first day of school? So the calendar is on our website. The first day of school will be September 6th.
Yes.
And meet the teacher, which is really important. It will be on Friday, September 2nd.
So So after Labor Day is the first day of school, and the Friday before is meet the teacher. So we'll send out invitation, because for meet the teacher, we don't have the schedule yet, but you'll get an invitation for that. And we'll have our first meetup, our park play date, in June.
Yes, it's on June 16th.
So we'll be at the playground. It's not the Fazry Playground, but we call it the Fazry Playground. It's a playground on Brook and Arnold around the corner from the school. From 4 to 6 p.m. on June 16th. So if anyone is local, we hope to see you there. If not, there'll be one in August, late August, to catch anybody who's finally has moved to the area.
We have another question about drop-offs and pickups. How do drop-offs and pickups work? Do we find parking and bring them in?
So you can do either or. If you want to bring them in, you have to find parking around on Hope Street, not in front of the school. If you want to do just use the drop-off line, then you have to stay in your car, get your child out of the car, and then drive away. Because it's a big line of car that will do that, and you don't want to block that traffic. And there will also be school buses that will be dropping off kids. Same with pickup. You can pick up, you line your cars up alongside the front of the school. There will be staff that will call your children and help bring them to your cars, and then you just drive off. But if you want to come and pick them up, you would come to the sidewalk and we'll get your children to you.
I think maybe we can take I'm not going in the order of questions, but what grades are eligible for the school bus? And then we'll talk about the other question.
So grades eligible for school bus are kindergarten and up. Younger than kindergarten, the school bus will not take you.
Another question, can you talk about how movement, play, music, and art are integrated in a pre-KK classroom? Oh, great question. Simon, can you talk about movement and motricity first?
Motricity, yes. And play, of course. Motricity isn't. We do motricity every day. Every day we either go to the auditorium to do it, or we go outside the park or in the playground to make games and work on motricity. It's often about playing together, teamworks, or jumping, throwing, and running, of course. So we do it every day. Play, in fact, we don't work, we play most of the time, because we learn through games, so we play a lot. And sometimes some kids say, we didn't work today. Oh, yes, we did. Did you learn something? Yes, I did. So you worked. Oh, that was work? Yes, it was. So that's kind of that's kind of the spirit we got in the classroom, you know. So playing is the best way to learn. So that's kind of motto. And music and art, they have teachers for that, and great teachers, I must say. They have music once a week. Mm-hmm. But we use music a lot in the classroom to learn nursery rhymes, for example, and so on.
And they have art once a week, and it's a block of two periods. Music and art are very integrated into the program. For example, if you're working on a theme of seasons or depending on a specific theme, you will find that in music, most probably. You will probably see an artifact in art that's related to what's happening in language or what's happening in the classroom. Teachers really work well together.
You're welcome.
And I like what Simon, you're saying about play. It's a lot about intentional play, I would say.
Yes.
Prepared by That's the it. Teachers with an intention and a goal. Well, there are also That's time it. When they can just play. I mean, play freely, right?
Freely, of course.
Especially
of course.
In petite section, but even in, I mean, in moyenne and grande section as well, of course. Any other questions? And if it's not questioned right now, do not hesitate. I mean, you know where to find Reysa. You can shoot us some questions. More than happy to discuss. Oh, can you speak about, okay, social, emotional, interpersonal skills. Great question. Thank you so much. We have actually a social worker on site. She is awesome, honestly. So she is our reference for our social emotional learning program, which is basically, which is based on the Yale program, where basically every moment is a teaching moment. So we really insist on self-awareness, expression of emotions, and then being able to breathe and stop, and then find a solution to a problem. Let's say I have a disagreement with a peer, okay? That's exactly the process and the method we're gonna teach. Name the emotion, let's start from there. And their language is really important in English and in French. Then breathe, pause, right? Express this emotion and be able to find a solution and make not make amend, but find a resolution to the problem, which could come in form of a canvas to appear or something they do together, and then we move forward. So we call that the meta moment. There are like five, you know, very common tools we use, and it's very pregnant in every classroom environment. Simon, I'll let you develop.
Yes, no, I just wanted to say that at the beginning of the year in pre-K 1, 2 and in kindergarten, we have a period of several weeks where we learn to identify our emotions and we learn the vocabulary, either in English or in French. The topics are the same. So we identify our emotions. So we'll go for simple emotion in pre-K 1 and we complexify throughout the years through pre-K 2 and kindergarten, so that we can talk about it and they can identify when the problem comes up and they can say, oh, I feel like that. Yeah, why do you feel? And we can discuss about it and we can solve problems thanks to the vocabulary, thanks to the knowledge they have about themselves. And that's very important for the rest of their scholarship.
They do a lot of teamwork as well. Simon talked about that, but collaboration, yes. Working on those peer-to-peer. I mean, the teachers can help a student, but student can help a student. And that's what's so great in a combined grade class as well, is that naturally you are in an environment when you're going to learn from everyone around you and you're going to teach the others. So it's very much of a mutual process that builds interpersonal skills.
They can, they are aware, like they can give to others and they can receive too, and they know how to receive things. They know how to give as a social being. And it's amazing that they do not need us at the end of kindergarten to help others and to have the idea to go and to take into account what the others' opinions or feelings. And that's great. That's great. And that's what we are trying to do through our maternelle. Mm-hmm. And throughout all the other.
So it's not a perfect world, right? I mean, there are going to be disagreements, there are going to be crises, all of that. It's about life. But I would say that overall, when we go around the classroom, there is there is a really positive, safe, and kind atmosphere. And that's exactly what we want. Okay, we're reaching 6 p.m. Maybe you want to move on to other activities. So as we said, we're gonna send the slides. Do not hesitate to send other questions and more than happy to have other conversation and continue the conversation. And thank you so much for being here. We were super excited to welcome you next year, first at the play date in June, please, at the park, and then next year. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Have a great evening.
Thank you. Have a great evening.
Au revoir.
Bye-bye.
Au revoir.
Au revoir.
Au revoir. Au revoir.